Good morning and happy Sabbath to each and every one of you. My name is Tammy Martins and I'm so excited to be able to be with you this morning and to share. I must say that I am a bit nervous, so I appreciate your prayers and your patience. And I also must say that I am missing Douglas, but very happy to have him and Rebecca be serving in Humboldt today. So why don't we start with prayer, please, if you can bow your head with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity to come together, to share, to worship you, and to be together as a church family. Dear Father, through the written word and my spoken word, please help us to hear the living word through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Please touch my lips, open our hearts, and transform our lives. Please be with each one here. Please be with those that aren't present, but we'll listen afterwards. Please be with me in a special way. And also we pray for Pastor Douglas and Rebecca as they're traveling and as they're serving in Humboldt today. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, would you agree with me when I say that no one craves attention more than children? What I've come to learn is that a lot of their need is simply to be seen and to be heard. But what does it mean to really see someone? I remember when I was doing my MBA, I was working full-time, and I was challenging myself to complete the accelerated program in 18 months rather than 2 years. And one evening, I was at home, I was studying, I was trying to cram in another assignment before work the next day, and Noah was about 6 or 7 years old at the time. And he was playing with his cars on the floor, and he said, "Mom, hey, Mom." And I responded with, "What?" Because I was busy, but my eyes stayed in my books. And Noah repeated again, "Mom." And 2 or 3 more times he kept repeating, and I remember being totally frustrated because I was listening, and I was even responding verbally to him. And if he just told me what he wanted, I'm very confident I could multitask. And he repeated my name again and again. And it really was clear that he was not satisfied with this. And he wanted my full attention. Insistently, and in a voice that tore at my heartstrings, he said, "Mom, look at me. Look at me in the eyes." No one knew I was only half listening. And he knew I definitely wasn't seeing him. In fact, he accurately perceived that I wasn't even trying to look. There are many times when my attention is pulled in so many directions. My phone rings, my text messages ping, there's new pandemic numbers, there's other local news happening, let alone all of the responsibilities at work and with home life, all that demands my attention. And in all this hustle and distraction, it's really hard to truly see others, isn't it? I found that it's so much easier to be absorbed by digital noise and really self-absorbed in all of my never-ending to-do list without realizing how blinded I've actually become to the inner lives of those who are nearest to me, my friends, my extended family, all of my community, and especially those who share my home and sit around my table. I've come to realize that this fragmented attention that I allow keeps me from really seeing with insight the people who mean the most to me. And by allowing myself to be too busy and distracted, keeps me from seeing and really hearing others with the sort of clarity that is essential to be a blessing to them. I'd like to go to Poll Everywhere, and I'd like to ask you a question. There's a lot of difference between hearing and seeing, and it requires going beyond what is said and includes what you see, and maybe what is unsaid, doesn't it? You need to listen to look at the meeting and really look and understand the need. It takes full attention. You're actively engaged, and you're listening to understand, and you're listening to learn. So in Poll Everywhere, I'd like to ask you, What makes it difficult for you to really focus on others so that you can both hear and see them in a meaningful way? What one word describes your challenge and your barriers that you face? So let's take a look at Poll Everywhere. So yes, I see some busyness, being late, devices. Those are definitely a distraction, aren't they? They can really monopolize our time. Simply being lazy is a way that makes it difficult to focus on others. Absolutely. Impatience, our minds, absolutely. They always seem to be busy and churning with information and things to do. Stresses in life, maybe denials that other people need support and help. Confidence, that's a really good one as well. Lack of love, very good. Really sticking out is selfishness, being in a rush, being busy, and being impatient. Thank you so much for all of your contributions there. That really sets the stage for us. And I'd like to dive into the Bible now and bring up the story about Jacob. When Jacob's son Joseph heard that his father was about to die, he brought his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim, to receive a blessing. And that's in Genesis 48, verse 2, where it says, "When Jacob was told, 'Your son Joseph has come to you,' Israel rallied his strength and sat up on the bed. Then Jacob asked his grandsons in verse 9, he said, 'Bring them to me so that I may bless them.'" And what's really interesting to me is verse 10. The King James Version tells us, "Now the eyes of Israel were dim with age, so that he could not see." This description perfectly echoes the description of Isaac in Genesis 27, verse 1. Jacob was blind. Just like his father Isaac, his eyesight degenerated with age. And this is a critical detail that I'd like to unpack more. So let's go ahead and look at verse 11. The moment when Jacob embraced Joseph, his son, he confessed, "I never expected to see your face again. And now God has allowed me to see your children too. God has let me see." Jacob might have been physically blind, but might this mean that his spiritual vision was strong? Because it was a God-given gift. The Andrews Study Bible for Genesis 48, verse 13 to 20, includes this comment: "Jacob may have lost most of his sight, but he still had prophetic insight. So God enabled Jacob to see his grandson, not with his degenerated eyesight, but really with a God-given lens. Jacob saw their value and their identity in relationship to the God who led and redeemed him. So seeing in this context is really a gift from God. He can give us spiritual discernment and insight that we can use and translate into blessings to others. We really don't muster this kind of spiritual vision and discernment through our own strength, do we? It really grows out of a relationship with God, and it's nurtured by prayer, worship, and trust. Do you recall a hymnal song titled "Make Me a Channel of Blessing"? I found this hymnal song this week, and the words are just so beautiful. Is your life a channel of blessing? Is the love of God flowing through you? Are you telling the lost of the Savior? Are you ready his service to do? Make me a channel of blessing today. Make me a channel of blessing, I pray. My life possessing, my service blessing, make me a channel of blessing today. So I'd just like to pause for a moment and really go through a type of imagery exercise with you. Imagine that you are a channel. Better yet, imagine that you're a pipe. The pipe could be any size, it's up to you. You are a pipe or a channel through which something flows. The reason why I ask you to imagine that you're a pipe is because there is something that flows through you. You are a pipe through which God's love flows. At one end, we are connected to that divine source. And at the other end, you are connected to family, your friends, your co-workers, neighbors, acquaintances. As God blesses us with His presence and provides for our physical and our spiritual needs, His desire is that we become a blessing to others. Somehow, we should become God's presence for other people. Somehow, we should provide for their physical and spiritual needs. As we are blessed by God, we really become the hands, the feet, and the mouth of God, so that His presence and His blessings may be experienced by others. This process of blessing others starts with the gift of seeing others, really seeing others, doesn't it? So let's just pause and take a moment and really digest this thought. I would like to go back to Poll Everywhere again and hear from you. How does it make you feel to hear about the awesome privilege and the responsibility that we have as children of God? As God blesses us, in turn, He wants us to become a blessing to others. So does it make you feel on Poll Everywhere? Does it make you feel excited? Does it make you feel motivated that you want to just get out there and bless others? Does it make you feel overwhelmed where the task is overwhelming? How do I fit this in? How do I do this? Do you feel unprepared? Do you feel maybe unworthy? When we were talking in our sermon lab earlier this week, Gary mentioned this one that, you know, sometimes as Christians, we could feel unworthy to serve, unworthy to actually be prepared to be a blessing to others. So what we're seeing is motivated. I love that. We're motivated with this awesome privilege and responsibility that God gives us, and maybe a little bit unprepared. So that is very good feedback. Thank you so much. I think I can help a little bit, maybe in some small way today, with this feeling of being unprepared and maybe give you some ideas that we can do so we can be a blessing to others. Thank you so much for your feedback. This gift of seeing and hearing others, which we are considering today, really isn't limited to physical vision, like we pondered about in that story of Jacob. It is really a spiritual blessing. It's a spiritual vision that enables us to see, to hear, and discern so that we can understand how we can be a blessing to someone. It really requires prayer. It requires inviting God to help us see how we can be used and how we can bless others. Colossians 1, verses 9 to 10 says, "For this reason, since the day that we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of His will through all the wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God." The information that the Apostle Paul had from the community of Colossae came through a report that was given to him. Even though it was not firsthand experience for Paul, God's gift of seeing others enabled Paul to care for the believers of Colossae and really become that blessing to them, because his ears were attentive to the report that was given to him by Epaphras, and that's in verse 7 and 8. Since that first day that Paul heard about them, he had been praying for them. There is really a beautiful circularity here that I'd like to point out. Our knowledge of God and our relationship with Him motivates our service. And that's what you guys said as well. This motivates you. And as we bear fruit in every good work, our knowledge of God increases, our relationship strengthens. Knowledge of God's will through spiritual wisdom and understanding are both gifts that are given to us from the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit who counsels us. The blessing comes when we connect these good gifts with their purpose. Living a life that's pleasing to others, pleasing to the Lord, and being in service to others. Living our lives with purpose and meaning is really a profound blessing. So God blesses us so that we can be a blessing to others. And how can we be a blessing to others? First, we really need to invite God to help us see others, to help us hear others, and really discern what their needs are so that we can serve. God is already at work. So what's great about our Lord is that He's already at work, and all we have to do is simply join hands where He is already working. I'd like to share some practical suggestions from a book that John Maxwell wrote. Some suggestions about how to be a blessing to others. The first thing is to really be intentional and to plan for it. And the second suggestion that he gives is to be quite the opposite, spontaneous, and seize opportunities as they arise. John Maxwell suggests that we take a quick look at our day's calendar because it can give us some great ideas. Who do you know that you will be crossing paths with today? Do you have a meeting with someone? If you're at home, maybe can you think about others that you haven't heard from or connected with in a long time and make a plan to do that before the day is done? So really being proactive and intentional. John Maxwell did exactly this when he challenged two young children to plan ahead. He said to them, "Think about how you can be a blessing to others during the day." So one of the kids decided that they would open the doors for other people throughout the day. The other decided that she would leave thank you notes for people and really express her appreciation. So they went out and they did it. At the end of the day, both children came back and they shared how positively people responded to all of their acts of kindness, their intentional acts. And it's all because they thought of ways to be a blessing before they started their day. The idea here is to really have an outward focus as you go throughout your day. These actions don't have to be big. They don't have to be expensive. Small, meaningful actions can really make a difference, can't they? The key for all of us, including myself, is that we really open our eyes so that we can see others, so that we can see what's happening all around us. And then we can be ready to seize opportunities as they present themselves. Listening requires humility and trust in the Spirit, but it is also an act of honoring those who we come alongside with the good news of Jesus. I heard Mandy talking about this in the teens worship today. As people seek to form apprentices of Jesus, we begin by listening to the voice of God. Listening forces us to set aside our own agendas and be open to the work of the Spirit among the community of God. When we are out of sync with the work of the Spirit, we can compromise our participation in the mission of God. The Missio Dei requires us to ask, where is God at work, and how can I be a part of what He is already doing? While failing to listen can have tragic consequences, being faithful in listening can create a birthplace for the dreams of God to be made manifest in the midst of humanity. And that's a quote from John Huckins in Thin Places. I love this book and I'd highly recommend it. I'd like to go back to that simple exercise that John Maxwell gave and really think about how can we be proactive and intentional about being a blessing to others. So I'd like to split you out in groups and let you have a few minutes to discuss. Can I challenge you to think about your day today or maybe the coming week that you have? Who will you be in contact with? Who are you crossing paths with? Where might you be purposeful about taking time to listen to someone, connect with them, pray for them, and determine how you can be a blessing to them. Discuss this with your breakout groups, and I'd love to hear from one or two of you. If you are feel so inspired, when you come back, please share. I'm looking forward to hearing back from you. Please accept the invitation to break out into groups at this time. Welcome back. I hope that that was enough time for each of you to talk in your groups, and I'd love to hear from you. What are some of the things that you discuss in your groups about how you can be proactive and maybe purposeful about blessing others in this coming day and this coming week? Gabriel, did you have somebody from, maybe one person from each of the groups would be amazing. I think there was three groups. Who's the first person that can share? Leo, I would love to hear from you and your group. Were able to get Leo up? What kind of things were discussed around the opportunity to be a blessing to others? Maybe just still connecting with Leo. I know that when I think about the week and the week ahead and who I'm going to meet and cross paths with, some ideas start coming. Did you find some ideas and things that in your group about what you can do throughout the upcoming days and weeks?
We talk that in this pandemic situation, we can at least call people using the internet, and we can pray together. And even being not close today, we can serve, we can help people stopping to listen to them.
Yes.
Right? Because in these times, as you said, people needs to have attention from the family, and needs to be heard from family and friends as well. So it's just to stop. I think it's just to stop and to talk with friends, talk with family, and to pray together. Because as human, we need to talk more, even in these times.
Thank you so much. I really think that's profound, Leo, because, you know, taking that time to pause and to stop and to ask and then to listen, it's really a challenge. And maybe Satan has thrown a little curveball in that with our pandemic, hasn't he? But your group is exactly right to be able to place a phone call and to be intentional in other ways. Thank you so much for sharing. I appreciate that. So who is our second group? I'd love to hear from you. Did you have any other ideas? Mandy. Hi, Mandy. Thank you so much for this morning. You blessed me when I was eavesdropping into your teen session this morning.
Oh, my goodness. I think Phil was designated to present, so I'm going to try to remember what we talked about. Okay. I think some things that we talked about were you kind of have to be sorted in yourself. You can't be empty and rushing and reacting to life because you're barely able to just handle what you have to do.
Yes.
So if you're intentional, you wake up, you have a planning session, you have a worship, you have your clothes laid out, you have your day sorted so that if something happens, you have time to make a phone call, or you have time to help someone or do something. Otherwise, you're just not available because you can barely handle
your day,
your life.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you for that. You know, things are so busy. I fully agree that if you're not intentional, and even if it's intentional with a small thing, your day is handled for you. It just takes over, right? And all of the duties, and you never do get to the bottom of the list. So if you're not intentional, it probably doesn't happen. Thank you so much for sharing. Hi, Tress. And so our third group, is there somebody that would be willing to share? That is it. Okay. Thank you so much. I really appreciate your feedback and your ideas. You've given me some ideas for this week as well. So our theme this year is blessed to be a blessing. We know that God uses people to accomplish his purpose, and he wants to take every single one of us on a spiritual journey where we have a close relationship with him, where we can discover our calling, and where we can really make a difference in the lives of others. John chapter 15, verse 8 and 11 says, "When you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples. This brings great glory to my Father. I have told you these things so that you would be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow." And this is such great news, isn't it? God is overjoyed when we make a difference in the life of others. When we do this, it ultimately brings joy to us as well, doesn't it? Real life is living life in a way that is beyond ourselves. Just like Mandy said, when we can get beyond our agendas, beyond our busy lives, and make a purpose to be a blessing to others. We are meant to be a vessel for God, aren't we? A pipe through which blessings can flow and can be shared with others. God asked us to love our neighbor in Mark 12, verse 31. And so my prayer is that we will continue to deepen our relationship with God as we do that. God will show us how we can love and care for His children. And God will give us that spiritual insight and that ability to see people exactly how He does, to see people how God does. I'd like to challenge you as you go about life this next week to really be purposeful about reaching out to someone else, to be proactive, to use that active listening so that we could really see others, to really hear them, to really understand what their needs are and what their burdens are. Because the more that we love people, the more that we lift them up in prayer, and the more we will want to be a blessing to others and really add value to their lives. So it's a really circular blessing. God blesses us, and we in turn can bless others through the spiritual insight that He gives. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for this opportunity to be together. We thank You so much for speaking to us about our awesome responsibility and our privilege to be a blessing to others, because You first have blessed us. Dear Father, I pray that we can be bold for You and give words of encouragement, blessing strangers, blessing others. May we truly be a blessing to those that we encounter. Please keep us in Your care and help us to get closer to You, because we know that the closer we come to You, the more that You can speak to us and help us have that spiritual insight so that we can in turn be a blessing to others. Let the love of Jesus shine so brightly that on the outside, people will be able to see and know that Christ lives in us. Please be with us. Please care for us as we go throughout our separate ways. We pray especially for those who aren't able to be with us today. In Jesus' name, amen.